First off, welcome. Goddamn it, welcome.
Are you ready? You ready?
This is the Bernie's Daughter Podcast.
I ain't scared of you, motherfucker.
The show where you get a front row seat to the magic,
are you ready?
Humor, and wisdom of the late, great Bernie Mac, as seen through the eyes of his loving daughter.
I don't care about you talking about me.
And his famous friends.
Hoya Witt, and welcome to today's episode of the Bernie's Daughter Podcast. I am your humble host, Janice McCullough, mostly known to y'all as Bernie's Daughter because, well, that's who I am, and that's what y'all call me. You already know that here on the Bernie's Daughter Podcast, we're all about celebrating my dad's life legacy, both in front of and behind the scenes. And also, we'd like to celebrate the people who we talk to. Our guest today has been acting since he was but a wee baby. He has an impressive resume, having voiced some iconic characters, such as one of my personal favorites, Coda from Disney's Brother Bear. But you all must know him and love him as the mischievous Jordan Tompkins from my dad's eponymous sitcom, The Bernie Mac Show. Please welcome to today's episode, Jeremy Suarez.
Hey, hey, hey. Thank you for having me. Thank you for having me, Janice. I'm super excited about this.
Me too. It's number one. It's always great to sit and talk with people who knew my dad to reminisce. But you and Camille and Dee Dee, y'all have such warm places in my heart. Like, it's just so good to see you guys all grown up. And it's just, oh my gosh, it makes me feel like a proud big cousin. I ain't claiming up these status. I'm claiming big cousin.
that's not my cousin.
Yes. Oh, so how have you been?
I've been really good. The strike's been going on, so everything's been slowed down, you know, on the whole like Hollywood thing. But honestly, just I've been enjoying my time with my family. I've been enjoying my time with my dogs, and really just learning, loving, and you know, and keeping it cool.
I love it, love it, love it. Well, let's start right on in. Of course, like I said, we all know you best as Jordan from the Bernie Mac Show. And I may ask both Dee Dee and Camille this because you all were so young. Do you remember your audition for the show?
Yeah, I do remember my audition because I remember the audition process, because it was, I think, one or two more auditions than you normally go to for like a regular role. And I do remember... I remember the first time I saw Bernie, which was in one of those auditions. And at that time, I didn't know like who Bernie was.
You should.
I wasn't going to comedy clubs at 9 years old. But I do remember him, even like when we were in that audition room, just being this character. Like, I had never seen anybody like Bernie. I don't think the world's ever seen anybody like Bernie, honestly. Because he was an electric character, man. Like, you just couldn't not feel anything about Bernie. And I remember, like, as a young actor, just being like, oh, wow, like, that's how I want to be, because it could take over a room like nobody else. And so even like when that first couple auditions, because I think it was, I want to say it was like four auditions total. And I think on the third one was when I first saw Bernie, and it was like, wow, okay, this is who we're going to be working with. Like, that was so, not intimidating. That was exciting, because if I was going to learn, hey, he looked like he had everything to teach.
And he did. He loved sitting and talking and teaching people. I love it. Love it. Love it. So, both Camille and Dee Dee said they got to audition with him. Did you eventually, like, after?
Oh, yeah. So the third audition was where I got to like, you know, read lines with him and everything. And like I said, that was like, that was when, you know, like, oh, okay. Like, we're going to have to go all out, because this dude is so cool. Like, there's no way to match it, but you gotta bring yourself up to some level. Wherever you can go, you bring it there.
But you did. See, first of all, for me, for the show, you were my favorite character. Jordan, hands down, was my favorite character. But you and my dad's chemistry was so wonderful. Like, I lived to see the scenes between the two of you all. What, like, and it's obvious that you all had that same chemistry off stage.
Yeah.
You know, yeah. Granted, of course, you weren't like Jordan, but still, you know, what was your off-screen relationship with my dad like?
I mean, like, when I got Bernie Mac, when I got that role, I was just turning 10 years old. I was like 9 or 10 years old. And like, I grew up in a single parent household. And so I was like 8 years old. So I was at this point in my life where I was barely kind of learning to have a father, essentially. And so Bernie came in and he was like a second one. And so it was so cool because he was able to show me what it means to be a Black man in an industry, to be a Black man and to be an entertainer and to be, you know, a leader of a group. Because, I mean, we had 300 people on set. And so it was like, you know, the humility and the kindness that Bernie really put out every day really resonated with me. And it stuck with me. I mean, I can't go, like, anytime somebody comes up to me and I don't have a fork in my hand, I'm signing an autograph or whatever, because that's how he was. And I remember, like, it being important to him when he met people to show them, hey, your appreciation of me matters to me. And that really resonates as a young man, like, to see that, because you don't see softness and kindness from Black men often. And so Bernie had that every day, everywhere he went. I mean, there was people who looked to Bernie not just because he was funny, but because he was a good dude, and because he would always really care about how you felt. And so, like, me and Bernie's relationship off stage was amazing, and the way he was able to teach me is something I really hold on to.
That's awesome. I'm so glad you said that about how, you know, generous and kind he was, you know, when it came to his fans. It always reminds me, I remember when we were working on Soul Man, and, you know, a lot of the extras, because that's, he would sit around and talk with the extras and, you know, oh, Lord. And I remember Samuel L. Jackson was like, man, don't let get on your nerves. And my dad was like, no, like, we wouldn't have this without them. And like,
yeah.
Yeah. Even when we were eating, when people came up, sure, he would tell them, you know what, I'm eating right now. But no, but it took a while for him to even get to that process.
Yeah.
Or
yeah.
Like, for years, he would be like, okay. And, you know, then it's full. Yeah. So it finally got to him. And having to get to that point, he was like, man, you know, I hate telling people no, but I'd like, dang, I gotta eat. Yeah. You know, I want people to get to see and know, not just, you know, Uncle Bernie,
yes,
3000, you know, all the things we come to know him for. I'm so grateful that you're saying that about him.
Well, like, that, to that point, I mean, I always feel like Bernie Mac and Bernard McCullough are like two different things. And like, I mean, I love Bernie Mac. I love Bernie Mac like the world loves Bernie Mac. But I knew Bernard McCullough, and that's who was really special to me. And and so, like, I don't know, like, I wish more people had gotten to see Bernie in those quiet moments when he was just being himself, because then I think they would have an extra appreciation. And that's why I really like this podcast idea, because it gives people the opportunity to hear from people who knew Bernard. And it's like, nah, it was. That person was as great as the other person who went off stage.
Yes, I always tell people, I'm like, if you ever go back and just watch his interviews or even read his book, he said it all the time. He would say, Bernie Mac is not who I am. Bernie Mac is a part of me. And it's true. Like, I tell people all the time, what you saw on stage, that was an aspect of him, but that wasn't the totality of who he was. Like, he would always tell people, I'm just an ordinary man with an extraordinary job. And
yeah.
You know,
we'll be getting out of that. I got actually that on some shoes. I got this, my face on one side, and on the other pair, it has his face, and across the top, it's that quote, because I love that quote. And that's like the modern day version of the dude who walks behind Caesar with the little pedals and hits and stuff. You're but a man. And it's so like I mean, if you ever need a good humble check, you just need to remember that, because it ain't about who you are. It's about just that little thing you did. That's it. You go back and you be a regular person afterwards.
Yes. I got you to have me a picture of those shoes. I would love.
Definitely will. I'm worn those shoes. They're a little dirty right now, but I'm definitely going to clean it and send you a picture out.
Yes.
They're one of my little treasures.
Oh, I love it. So, did you know that the character of Jordan was based on my dad from when he was a little boy?
No, I didn't know that. That's crazy, because I was always, because I always get this question. People ask, like, oh, like, did you guys ever meet Bernie's niece and nephew?
I feel so bad when I have to tell people it was just a joke and them kids ain't real. I feel so bad for them. Because you can see the heartbreak on their show. When I tell them, oh, these kids aren't real. And they just like crank. You can see the crack. Like, wait, the kids aren't real? No, baby, those kids aren't real.
You know, so I did not know that Jordan was based off of Bernie as a kid,
yes,
which is like funny, because I mean, it makes sense, because Bernie was a troublemaker. So
a troublemaker. I will never forget my great grandfather. And I was little, because he died when I was like 9. But I remember he was like, oh, I used to get so tired of beating your father. I used to get so tired. He said, and then, you know, he had to tell me one day. He said he had the nerve to just tell me, you might as well go on and beat me right now, because I'm still going to do what I want to do.
Yep. That was something, because, I mean, sometimes you just got to poke. You got to poke the bear a little bit. Sometimes you got to poke the bear, and it's going to be worth whatever repercussions. And Bernie would almost see that in your eye, like when you're making a joke and somebody getting a little irritated, you got to press a little bit more. He would see that, and he'd be like, oh, you just like me. That's because we saw Bernie would not let a joke die. But we'd have some jokes that would just go on and on.
I don't want to answer.
You don't got people, or you don't have many people who are that just true, honest about themselves. They know themselves. And hey, you take it, you can meet me for it, but I'm still gonna be me. And I mean, that's a light that shines.
Yeah. That's one of the things when people ask me, like, what do I miss most? That's one of the things I always say. I'm like, I have yet to meet anybody that was just that honest with me about, you know, everything about who he was, about who I like. And I miss that. I miss having somebody who, you know, just the unadulterated truth. I really do.
Yeah. There was no pretense with Bernie. Oh, if Bernie thought it, he was going to say it.
No.
And he was going to think he was going to formulate it in a way that not only was it like, all right, that's crazy shit, but we going to tell you. We going to tell you. And it's funny. And we may, you know, it's cracking but facking. Sometimes you got to have some humor with the truth. Because the truth may be a little bit too painful. You know, if somebody walk into an elevator and they stink, you know, you have to find a way to lighten up the mood and say, ooh, you smell like you're healthy. Like, you go to the gym all the time. Good for you. You know, I'm back in a little argument.
I'm using that just so you know. You smell like you're healthy. I'm using that.
All the time. I like that. Hey, good for you. I'm too lazy.
Is there a little bit of stand up in you?
Hey,
I'm feeling right. I'm detecting.
Hey, you gotta cram with fact on that one. There's a lot of situations where, you know, it's like it's the spoonful of sugar for the medicine of truth.
Absolutely. I love it. Love it, love it. So we were talking, like, you were young, you were like 9 when you finally, when you auditioned. So, of course, like I said, no, you didn't know who he was. How old were you when you finally were able to see his stand up?
Honestly, I think after I got the role, I went and watched the show. I went and watched the comedy special. I had to, because it was like, all right, this required viewing at this point, you know. And,
Of course, some of those jokes were going directly over my head and all that. But just seeing his energy and seeing how people loved him was enough for me to get it. It kind of, you know what I mean? That was the building blocks.
I love it. Love it. Love it. Do you have a favorite moment with my and his boss? Let's say either off or on, but both on screen and off screen.
Okay. Yeah. I think one of my favorite moments, and this is just, I believe I'm not sure if it was a spelling bee, but we were doing a scene in Jordan's school's like auditorium. And the scene, I fall out and Bernie runs over to me and he slapped my face and said, Wake up, boy. And so the second time we did it, he came over and he goes, Wake up, boy. But he hit me too hard. He hit me too hard and realized it. And she goes, wait. And so Bernie, he goes, oh. And I think that ended the game they used because it's genuine, like, shot up my face. And so afterward, I go, I'm going to mess with Bernie. I'm just not going to get up. So I'm laying there. And just get up. Oh, my God. I'm so sorry. I didn't mean to hit you. I didn't mean to. And that was so genuine of him. That was like, it was just hilarious. I mean, it didn't hurt that bad. It's like a little bit, but the way he immediately went into worry. And there was a story that Bernie used to always tell about one of the funniest things that he had ever seen. And it was one time the projects had burnt down. And he was saying, seeing all of these people run out, it was just so, it tickled him for some reason. It tickled him. And that was my feeling about that. Seeing Bernie so scared about slapping me, I was like, God, this is really funny. And so it's something I always think about because no matter how big of a dude he was and how intimidating he may seem, he was a big softie who was really worried about her people. And that's it.
First of all, he was heavy-handed as all get out. So sometimes
he was.
But yeah, you're right. Like he his bark was so much bigger than his bite. Like he, even when he was mad, he would be mad. He might, you know, go off or he cuss you out and do all of that. It was like, hey, okay, let's go back to acting like nothing have happened.
Yeah. He was mad. He was mad at the thing that happened. And he was a really even keeled person, like surprisingly. I think a lot of entertainers or actors or whatever aren't as genuinely mellow as Bernie was. And in his off time, I remember Bernie like hanging out with crew and everybody, and it was just such a good environment for everybody on set that it was like, I mean, like I said, even 15 years after he's passed, and I still have not heard anybody who has anything bad to say about Bernie. Nobody says, oh, he wasn't nice. Oh, he was a jerk. Oh, mm-mm, not once. And that is like, that is unheard of to me.
Yep. I say the same thing. I'm like, 15 years later, somebody would be like,
yeah.
All right, listen, I know everybody think he great, but everybody like, mm-hmm. Yeah, I say that all the time.
Yeah. There's no way the whole world would hide that secret for 15 years. No way.
Exactly. Somebody would have been like, I can't wait to tell the world about how I say that. Yeah. I always attribute it to, I really think the fame came to him at a really good time in his life. He was much older. Because I always say, like, if it had happened, not that he wouldn't have been a nice guy in his 20s, but young Bernard and older grown man Bernard are two different things.
Yeah.
That was that. I don't remember what I said last. I don't. So
okay. We were talking about Bernie. And so but we were saying how
how everybody wouldn't hid that secret for 15 years. If you were secretly a bad dude, and you were saying them that he had kind of hit fame at the right time in his life.
Exactly. And
yeah, I honestly agree with that, because you see a lot of people whose rise to celebrity is so quick that it overwhelms or overshadows the hard work that they had to or may not have had to get there. And it becomes their ego becomes bigger. They start thinking it's not about them, it's about them rather than the work that they're doing. And Bernie had a really he knew very clearly that he was like, hey, I'm here because I'm funny. I'm here because I can entertain people. And it was always about not him, but what he was doing and how well he could make other people shine. Mm-hmm. And like looking back on the show, you see so many episodes that are not about Bernie, you know, about something else in one of the other cast members' lives. Mm-hmm. And the way that he was able to share, you know, to share his light with others is something that a lot of people, if that rise was too quick, would be able to lose track of, because it's hard.
Absolutely. Absolutely. But you know, that was always that sharing of, you know, allowing other people to shine. That was always a part of who he was, because even when I was a little girl, when he was, you know, pursuing stand up, he and quite a few other comedians, he was trying to put together a comic union so that, yes, because there was always discrepancy, you know, within the comedy clubs between who got paid what, you know, and he just wanted to make an even playing field so that it was fair across the board for all comics. It, like, you got a union, you know, everybody gets paid the same thing, and then that part of it gets taken out of it and everybody gets to shine. Like, so yeah,
that's still something that people need today. I mean, there's so many, not only comedians, but now you have internet performers who don't have that collective bargaining protection that everybody needs. And to see that, our little set was a little microcosm of it, but we were all a team and we all ate, and Bernie, it always tripped me out, because every lunch, Bernie would always have food, not only for himself, but for everybody. Hey, you can go up to Bernie's room. And so, that idea of, hey, all for one and one for all is something that we need more of today.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. I love it. I love that you said that, because that, him and food, listen, if you weren't going to do anything else with him, you were going to eat. You know, his music. It's just like, you know,
there's some places out here that Bernie would order for lunch, like on set. And so, like, I'll still go in and, you know, I'll still go in and have a meal, get like some oxtails and stuff. It's so awesome, man. So, like, there's still, like, even in this city, there's still things around here that are so, like, quintessential Bernie to me or anybody who knew him. You know, there's still little bits of, like, there's still little bits of him everywhere.
Yes, I love that you said that, because that's him. Like, it, you know, I still live in the city that I grew up in. So, of course, everything Chicago is him.
Yeah.
Loved it. So
hey, when I come to Chicago, where's the one place that was like Bernie's little hidden favorite that I got to go? That you like, oh,
I'm gonna go to Lawrence for seafood.
Okay,
you've got to go to his favorite soul food place is closed now, but okay, definitely got to do Lawrence. He loved Gino's East Pizza, and actually, his favorite though was Williams Inn. Now it's in the hood, and it's the hours it, because it was like a little lounge too. But if you want to try deep dip, you want to do a deep dish. That was his favorite.
Okay.
Yeah, but definitely Lawrence. You've got to go to Lawrence Fisheries, because that was his spot. He's gonna be, and matter of fact, after I gave birth and I had to have a C-section so I couldn't eat, he sent his driver all the way out to Lawrence. And because I gave birth out in the south suburbs, and Lawrence is like on the complete opposite side.
That's awesome.
He sent his driver there. He had everybody come to my room, and everybody was like, how is that lit on Friday nights when y'all rapped? That's what my hospital room looked like.
That's awesome. That's awesome. Yeah. That's awesome.
Yes.
I, on the, when we, every Friday, you know, he throw a little bump and grind, he called it, where everybody on the show would come out and they would watch bits of the episode that had already been edited. And I remember the most popular thing at the time for the crew was the margarita machine. They had a, so I hope there was no margarita machine in there, but other than that, probably the same thing. It probably had music and food and a whole bunch of people, so it was cool.
It was music, it was food, no margarita machine. You know, NGB was his drink, so he had him bring like a 12-pack of NGB.
That's nonsense. That's nonsense.
Yeah. Oh my gosh, I'm having so much fun doing this. Do you have a favorite episode? Because mine is two, it's tied. Mine is Eye of the Tiger and Goodbye Dolly. Those are my two favorites. And it's always for you, like Goodbye Dolly, especially the scene with you all in the car.
I love that scene with the wood chipper.
Yeah.
It's so great. I think my two favorite episodes, I mean, Eye of the Tiger, the whole process of making that and just that whole episode to me was just so much fun to make. And it was so like off screen funny as well as on screen funny. I feel like that week I may have laughed more than I did in my entire life because it was something I had never done. So like the whole process of just even learning to do the ribbon dancing and all of that was like, it was so funny because like me as an actor, I was having fun with it. But the lady who was teaching me, she was super serious. She was like Olympic level lady. So she was like, just this contrast of her being like, okay, I see you're having fun. I know you're only going to do it for 30 minutes, but you're going to do this right. Like, I'm not going to put my name on, you know, you not making it look right. And it was just so funny the entire time. She would go, jump higher, jump higher, less louder. I was like, oh my God, that lady. It was just, it just tickled me and it still tickles me. And then the second episode, that's my absolute favorite, just because I think on screen it's so funny, is Sin Cup. Where Fiona is worried about going to hell and my brother going to hell. And it's just because she was so young. She was so little when we did that episode that like, I remember when we first started working, Didi, she actually thought Bernie was her real uncle. I mean, that's how young she was. She had no like connection that this was like a TV show. And so that episode, I just remember being so like cute because Didi didn't know she was doing. She was just there, but it just worked. And on screen, it just tickles me like that whole connection of those things. It's just so, it's great, man. Like it, even if I wasn't on the show, I'd like the show. I feel like there, that episode is one of those, great connectors of people. Like there's if you're Catholic, if you're Christian, if you're Buddhist, if you're Jewish, you can find a moment in that episode that just will you know what it's about, you know what it is. And I think that very few episodes, not only of TV but of anything, really connect across that many strata.
I love that you said that. I remember there was one year, my ex-husband, he and one of his co-workers, and his co-worker, he's from Connecticut, so, you know, you already know. And it was the season, I can't remember what season it was, when you all were up against Friends on Thursday nights. And they went on a conference. They had a conference to go to. And my ex-husband told him, he said, listen, I know you used to watch your Friends on Thursdays, but tonight we're not watching Friends. We're watching the Bernie Mac show. And when they came back, I remember when I saw him, he was like, oh, wow, I watched your dad's show for the first time. And I loved it. I laughed so hard. You could tell like that was his first time, you could tell for him, it was like, I went in thinking I would never had anything to relate to in this show. Mm-hmm. And he watched it and was like, boy, was I wrong. So
yeah. It was even more so than a Black show. It was an American show. And it was something that really, like, everybody who has kids understands Bernie's feelings in those situations. Yeah. Whether in Black, brown, or blue.
Exactly. And I loved that it tackled raising children that aren't biologically your children, but come to love and acknowledge as your own. Because when you dive deep into, like you said, across the board in families, you will find somebody who was raised by someone who was not your biological, you know, grandparents raising kids, auntie took in, you know, this, you know. So I really love that the show did that. I really do.
I mean, at the core of it, it's about the fact that we all just have to make a decision to love each other.
Yes.
I mean, just like on set, we all decided, hey, we all are a team. We all are a family. And like from the very beginning of the show to the last day, I think we had like 90% of the same people, because everybody felt that there was like, all right, we've all decided that this is what we're going to put our time and our effort and our love into. And it shows. It showed, because we all made that decision, just like Bernie's character made that decision to take in those kids.
Yep. I love that. You have a way of saying things that I'm like, oh my gosh, I love that. So I know, I get tagged so much in this clip, so I know you have the photo shoot of you all doing the TV guy photo shoot where you're like paying a lot of your time. Mm-hmm. And the assistant is giving y'all directions of where to sit. And you're like, you know, where am I? And first, you know, she's like telling you to sit on my dad's lap, and my dad's like, oh no. And basically put you down right there. Like, no, you just sit right there. Go ahead. People look at it and I think they give it more meaning than it meant. Mm. At the time, because for him, he's too big to be sitting on my lap. Oh, boy, get down over here.
Bernie was such a Bernie was a real dude, man. I mean, he was so authentic. If just something wasn't right, it's like, nah, that's not how we're gonna do it. And like that was, even on set, like there'd be moments where it's like, is this funny or is this work? And it'd be like, nah, like this, it doesn't connect. It's not, you know, that's that honesty there. Yes. It's like, nah, this not, it don't work. Like, in that picture, it works, but then this one, it don't. Like, let's change it and make something better of it.
Yes.
It was like, Bernie was just super, super genuine. If he didn't like something, he was going to say something, you know? So, and I definitely agree that, people put way too much on it. It was just, hey, we were trying to frame it up right or whatever. But Bernie was, you know, and Bernie had an idea in his head about how he and his show was to be portrayed. And like, that's his legacy. So, I mean, but that's how it has to go, man. We all follow Bernie, like, you know, one, two step, baby.
Yes, indeed. Okay, so I hate talking about this, but you know, I gotta ask. If I don't, folks be like, why didn't you ask him about it?
Okay.
Because you were 16 when my dad died, correct? Mm-hmm. Yeah, so. What was that experience like for you? Like when you heard my dad died and
just that was, it was shocking to me, honestly, because I had seen Bernie's, his health issues, but to 16 year old me, the idea of Bernie dying, that was not even that never in the forefront, because he was such a strong man, you know, and he was such a, he had so much life in him. And so it was more so shocking, and it took me a long time to really get out of that like completely shocked phase of it, really. And once I finally was able to get past that step of grieving, man, it took a long time to really process all of those things, because for me it was this person who was my role model, who was my friend. But it was also a job. It was also my whole job. Like everybody I knew for the last 9 years, it was like a lot. And so it was really difficult. And I remember like one of the last times I had talked to Bernie, I talked to him on the phone, and he was telling me about just having faith and about how everything happens for a reason. And I just remember holding on to that after he passed away, and that, of course, it wasn't no premonition, nothing, but it helped me to accept the fact that Bernie was so, he was comfortable in his faith, and he was accepting of anything that life gave him. And so in him, his passing, I mean, now we have to do that. So, I mean, yeah, it was extremely difficult, but yeah, we got through it. And now that it's 15 years later, I feel just incredibly, incredibly lucky to have gotten to know him, and just so appreciative of all the things that he taught me.
Yeah, I love that. It's, you and D.L. Hughley are the two people who have said your words have pretty much echoed exactly what I was feeling. Because you just, like you just said, like, he's a superhero to you. I was 30 and I was like, no, he's not dying. Like, that's not what's going to happen. Like, even, you know, when the doctors were, you know, giving us grave news, like, it's not looking good. I was like, I don't care what y'all say. Do y'all know who's in that hospital bed? Like, no. So then.
Yeah, he had this aura about it.
Yeah.
And then it was, yeah, I think anybody who knew Bernie and. Because I remember just the outpour of love. I mean, there was so much love when he did pass that came, you know, from everywhere. I mean, fans to, you know, it was, I had never seen that big of a display for anybody who looked like us. And still to this day, I mean, we're sitting here talking about it today. I mean, he'll never, hopefully, he should never stop getting his flowers, because what he did when he was here was so amazing. And I was watching Monique, Monique's talk the other day, and she said about 100 years. And I'm like, yeah, at the minimum, because he is like, the next person who comes along who is halfway as funny, halfway as talented, halfway as genuine and kind as Bernie, hey, we'll give them the world. But until then, hey, everything's lined up for Bernie right now. You know what I mean? He's the dude.
Yeah. Oh, I love that you said that. Like, you and the crew, do you all still get together every year?
Not every year, but it's still, well, but nearly often. Every like, I mean, I still see Dee Dee and Camille and even like, Well, wardrobe people and set directors. I still like he was able to create such an atmosphere of family that a lot of those people are still like coming to Thanksgiving and all kinds of cool stuff. Like, we still are family. So that's just a testament to how genuine it was. You know what I mean? We wasn't just faking the funk. No, we still connect.
That's beautiful. I love it. Okay, we're going to switch gears just a little bit.
Okay,
I want to talk about you and get into you. You have been acting. I mean, you were a baby. Like, you did Pampers commercials.
Yeah.
Like, I remember your Honey Cheerios commercial. And because I remember thinking, that is the cutest little boy I've ever seen in my life. Oh, my gosh. Like, who is he?
I love acting. I love my craft, and I've been lucky enough to do it since I was super, super small. And it was always like, it was always something I really enjoyed to do. And a lot of people are not lucky enough to be able to find what they like to do in their lives. I found mine when I was like 2 years old. And so I was doing it before I loved it, but by the time I loved it, I mean, I was already doing it. And sometimes that's how it has to be, because like that gave me so much experience. And like by the time I was on Bernie Mac, you know, I had already been working for like 6-7 years.
Yeah.
Or like that's I don't know. I mean, I'm amazingly lucky in that. And it's just it's something that like compared to like any other field that you do, it has like a dynamism. Like, it's so dynamic. Like, every day you get to work and it's something new. Every day, every moment is going to be, have its own unique challenges. And like, it's like a little puzzle that everybody on set is trying to build up together. And it's just something I just truly, truly love.
Oh, that's awesome. I think I heard you say that your mom, like, dabbled in child acting.
Yeah, my mom was an actress when she was little. Yeah. I think she was on Dreamcatchers, which is one of the first Disney shows on Disney Channel. But yeah, she stopped when she was like 17. It wasn't for her. Like, I feel like with acting, because you're going to have a lot of rejection and you have a lot of, it's a difficult gig. And if you don't really, really love it, you know, it's not worth the time. Like, if you really want to go be rich, you better go be a banker. Like, if you want to go and, you know, build something like from scratch, then it's easier to be a baker. You know, like, there's so many, like, easier, kind of more well-defined paths than if you are not, like, a little bit crazy. Yeah, if you're a little bit crazy. You're a little crazy. Then, you know. Yeah, you do.
You did. Yeah. I was going to ask you about that because there's so much rejection that you get in that field. Like, as a kid, how did you navigate that? Like,
I never made it a priority to myself. Like, and I was always just a kid. I was always just a kid. And this was always just something I did. Like, it's not like when you're an adult and you have like bills to pay or something. Like, it's just a little extra. It's a little land gap. Like, for me, like, I used to act because I really liked to act. And I knew that if I got a role, I'd go to Toys R Us and I could pick out one toy. I was like, all right, that's cool. Like, that's good enough. Like, that's better than baseball. Like, okay, like, you won the championship, but you had the new Power Rangers? No? Okay, well, like, you should be acting. And so for me, it was just something like, all right, it's like, there's not no pressure on it. Like, there was more pressure still on getting good grades in school than there was getting a role. But, like, that kept it away from, like, that, like, nagging feeling. Because, like, even as an adult, like, I've always decided to work a separate job just so that if I get an actor role, I'm not like fretting over it. It's not my whole day. It's just, all right, hey, it's just something I do. And if you don't, I learned that from Bernie. If you don't make that separation, it's going to drive you crazy. And then if you do ever make it, it's going to go directly to your head.
Yeah. I'm going to get into you with the separate jobs from acting in a minute, but the flip side of that. So we talked about the rejection that comes with that. But like you said, that now when you make it, so for you, you became this huge child actor, you know, Jerry Maguire, your voice in Coda and Brother Bear. And then you get the show. Was there any point during your childhood where you realized that you were a famous child actor?
Yeah, I guess when I was signing an autograph, but I didn't know how to write cursive yet. But I was like, oh, like, maybe I should learn to write cursive, man. Like, maybe I should focus in school because I guess this is something I will need. Like, so, like, yeah, I guess, I mean, I knew people knew who I was, but, like, to me, I mean, I was no SpongeBob, you know?
You're hilarious. I love it. Oh my goodness. Now, the show ended at an interesting time for all of you all because, you know, when it started, you all were little and everybody was like, oh, they're still so cute and little. And then now when it ends, you all are in that strange space for child actors where you're not so little anymore, but you're also not quite, you know. So, at that point, did you want to continue acting and was it difficult to be seen now as, okay, I'm Jeremy Suarez, an actor, and not just, oh, this is Jordan?
Oh, yeah, definitely. I mean, I think it's very easy for, because we're in an industry in which people can see everything, sometimes it's hard for people who can't see something to imagine it.
And so, like, for the longest time, they had seen me as Jordan, 6 years. I mean, this is at this point, this is like almost a half of my life or something. You know, I mean, a third of my life. And it's like, okay, we can only think of you as that. And that was a little bit difficult because you have to go in and you have to fight against your own expectations. You know, your reputation will definitely walk in before. And it was also challenging because not only was I known only or not primarily for Bernie Mac at that time, but also people had such strong emotions about Bernie that they weren't able to not hide. And so I'd be going to auditions and it'd be like, let's say a fun, happy go lucky roll. But then right before the audition, people wanted to like talk about Bernie's dance and everything. And I'd be like, bro, this is a little inappropriate. Like, that, yeah, it wouldn't put you in a good headspace.
Right.
And so you got to tough it out. It took me a long time to really like place all of those things in the right box so that I was able to get back onto my grind. Because it was definitely a challenge. I was 17, so it's way more expensive to hire a 17-year-old than an 18-year-old because they have to hire teachers and there's child labor laws. And, you know, I had this image of like, oh, is this Jordan? I wear glasses. It was definitely challenging, but struggle makes you strong. And so, like, I'm happy all of those times were early in my life because now I know how to get through those things now. Like, that point in my life taught me really well about setting boundaries with people. Like, because, hey, like, some days, it may be your first time meeting me and you want to be sad with me, but I'm going to be like, nah, it's not the time right now to be sad. You know, it's that fork and the autograph type thing with Bernie. And so I had that moment of learning kind of how to set boundaries with people. And it sucks. You want to have that commissive moment, but you have to learn just what's good for yourself ultimately, because I was grieving and I grieved for quite a while with Bernie.
Oh, listen. If no one else understands, just know, oh, I completely understand.
Hey, I know you, cousin. I know you. I know.
Yeah, that was a tough time. Like, you know, it would be weird. Like, walk into a store thinking I'm about to grocery shop and somebody, you Bernie's daughter, aren't you?
Yeah, and like, oh,
and I'm like, oh, wait, I'm translating
right now. Like, right.
And it goes, some days I'm like, I was feeling good when I walked in here. I was doing good.
Here you go.
Like, yeah.
And I was really lucky because I had a whole bunch of family around me. And that was my, I had my safe place. And so it really, that taught me just a big lesson about the people who care about you are going to be caring about how you're feeling more so than they caring about, you know, a moment or whatever. And so, like I said, it was such a crazy time in my life, but I mean, I got through it and it's such a powerful lesson that I hope to be able to pass on because there's so many good lessons in all of those hard times that, I mean, you gotta keep pushing them down, you know? Somebody else has to benefit from it.
Yeah. I love that you said that. Yeah. Because that's generally what I try to do when I write, when I'm talking. It's, I know what it feels like to have gone through these difficult moments. And it's like, what's the point if I just keep the lessons to myself?
Yeah.
And, you know, also on the flip side of that, a lot of times when we go through, you know, difficulties, we tend to get in our heads and tell ourselves we're the only one, like no one else has ever experienced.
Yeah.
No one else understands. And so I'm always like, no, just if you think no one else has been through this, if you think no one else understands, just know you have somebody over here. Yeah.
I was watching one of Bernie's stand-ups the other day, and he was telling about how it was once in the King's Comedy, and he was talking about how he goes, don't judge me. Some of your family fucked up too, and that's the thing. If nobody is willing to take that first leap and say, all right, hey, I got some issues, I've been through this, like, that may inspire somebody else to say they have some issue. That may inspire somebody else to be like, I got a solution for yours. I mean, that's the basic connection. It has to be, as I'll start with, I got a problem. Either y'all can fix it or, you know, we're going to fix it together.
Yep. I love it. Speaking of giving people inspiration, let's go to you. Go like leaving acting and pursuing like regular jobs. So you said you worked in construction. Then I think I saw you say you worked in the culinary world. Mm-hmm. And then you did retail for AT&T.
Oh, yeah. A little bit of everything. A little bit of everything. Why not? Why not? Life was too long to be bored. And every job that I've done, I've learned something at. And it's something that is relevant to not only like other jobs, but to me as a person. You know, like I went on to a construction site. I was scared of heights. I didn't realize it until I got up top. And I was like, oh, yeah, I'm scared of heights. And you can only be scared for so long. So after like 3-4 weeks, I wasn't scared of heights no more. And so like that, directly seeing that even something you're really scared of can be turned into something that's normal and something that you can overcome was a great lesson. Like a great lesson I got paid to learn.
I know.
And like retail, I really enjoyed retail. I was able to really luckily work with like great managers who were, had a lot of integrity and a lot of.
Oh, you were lucky.
No, straight up. And it was like, I mean, you carry that on anywhere. Anytime somebody is trying to convince someone or show the benefit of something to someone, I mean, there's that little bit of retail in there. There's that little bit of salesman job.
True.
I mean, a CEO is just a retail person and talk to other CEOs to sell that shit. So
true. Yeah.
I mean, it's I learned that from there. I was I worked in the kitchen. I worked. My mom does catering. And mom does. I mean, she's the most amazing chef you've ever met. She's a cordon bleu trained. And I was working with her, and we would cater for like 70 people dinners. We would do like concession stands, and that teaches you about like accuracy, spillers, so much you've learned in the kitchen. Everybody I think should work in the kitchen. Like that's the one I go, okay, everybody probably needs to. And then you learn how to cook for yourself, so you'll never be hungry. Because especially as a man, like all dudes need to learn how to cook. Like because, and I'll tell you why, fellas, I'll tell you why. Because then when you're looking for a lady, fellas, she don't have to cook. She don't have to be able to cook. You can be like, all right, she can't cook, but she's pretty and she's sweet and all that. And so, like, working in the kitchen was like, man, I still cook to this day because of, like, the lessons I learned in there. And for me, because I was an actor already, it gave me the opportunity to not always have to be, like, thinking about a job as just money. It was like, nah, I'm going to go in here and I'm going to, like my mom always say, you got to work for God. You got to go in there and do a good job, not just because you're going to be making some money, but do a good job because that's your work, your name is on it. And it's something where like, I'd be working hard at construction. Like, I don't care. Like I'm tired as hell at the end of the day. I'm broke down, beat up. But just because I don't need the job or whatever, don't mean I'm not going to be there in the mud with everybody else, because Bernie will be there too. If he was, yeah. I remember we would do our confessional scenes, like where all the confessionals on Friday. And sometimes they would go to like 10:30, 11 o'clock, and they'd be broke down, tired, beat up, tired. But Bernie was going to be the last person off cell working with everybody. So, I like working because I've done it since I was 10. But then I also like just seeing the benefits of the personal benefits that work brings.
I love it. You are so wise. I love this. Yes. So, You strike me as someone who takes lessons from pretty much everything that you do. Mm-hmm. What lessons have you learned from being married? Ooh, and congratulations, by the way.
I mean, you learn about compromise. You learn about
You learn about good communication. That's the biggest one. That's the biggest one. Because like the way you say something is much more important than what you're saying. Mm-hmm. And it's really easy to not take responsibility for your own communication. And then when conflict happens because of that, you sit there like, what happened? Well, because you didn't say it right. Like, and so being married has taught me to, you know, to work with this this other person, to communicate and to just be just always be striving for somebody else, you know. It's a beautiful thing. It's a beautiful thing.
Well, I'm so glad you said that about communication, because I think so often when people give the advice to married couples to communicate, it's just talk mm-hmm. without taking in all the nuances and layers that come with talking, because it's so easy to have a miscommunication. Because, and I say this all the time, like I ask a lot of questions when I'm talking to people, and I ask a lot of clarifying questions, because for some people that's annoying, but I do it because an example that I always give is I'm like, if I was in a room with 20 people and I told everybody to close their eyes and picture a desk or picture a tree, we're all going to picture something completely different. Or you have those people who they're not even visual, so they can't even picture a tree. Like, you know, when you start into those.
Yeah, right.
So depending on what, you know, you pick, like whatever the tree is that you imagine in your head, depending on what I said for you, that tree is going to require something completely different.
And on that point, I was watching some video, and he said that sometimes people think that we are defining things. Oh, this is this. This is this. He said, but really, we're trying to visualize the other person's map of it. Oh, you think it's over here? Okay, I think it's a little bit over here, and we're trying to figure out what that we're looking at. We don't know if it's this or that until we both look at it together and say, okay, I think it goes right here, right here, right here. And helping other people kind of define that map and being like, all right, we're talking past each other because we're not using the same language. You're talking about this, I'm talking about this. Like, and having that honesty and being like, all right, I don't get it. Maybe you don't get it because it's just not, but you have to kind of look at that map with your partner and be like, where is this communication getting off? Okay, there. You think it's that. Okay, that's not what I'm saying. Okay, let's keep on going.
And that was so good. And you kind of broke up. Can you say it again? Because I want to make sure that that's stated. Exactly. I don't want that to be cut out at all.
Exactly. We're both just trying to get down this river. We both just trying to get down this little river on the map.
Yeah, I love it. I love it. Okay, I saw you say that you are very big on advocating for young Black men. Mm-hmm. One, I love that you do that. Yeah, but what inspired you to feel that way and to do that?
The most important job I have, which is being a big brother. Like, because at one point, like, I mean, it's just going to be me and my brothers, essentially. Like, I mean, my parents and my grandparents will pass on, and we have to be there for each other. And even at our age now, we're still super connected. And even when they were young, like that's always been like a big thing to me, like being there for them. And I know that there is so many young Black dudes out there who don't have like a big brother for themselves. They don't have nobody. I was the oldest, so I would have loved to have a big brother to tell me right from wrong and this is the way to do it. Like, I would have been even cooler than I am today. Like, I'm cool. I would have been the shit. So it's like, I just think it's really important to connect with people who look like you and who are at that time in their lives where there's opportunity to do things about it and to fix their whole life path, you know? So that's what it is.
Oh my gosh, bro. I have enjoyed this so much. And this is your final question. As this is the Bernie Sorter podcast, we got to end on the same note that we began.
Okay.
Okay. So what is it that, because you mentioned Bernard Jeffrey versus Bernie Mac. Mm-hmm. So for you, what is it that you think people should know about, not just Bernie Mac, but Bernard Jeffrey?
That if you really want something, if you really, really want something, all you got to do is set your mind to it, work hard, and get people around you who also want something similar, and it can happen. Because that's when I think of Bernie, and I think of, like, he knew he wanted to make people laugh. He didn't know how that was going to look, but he started off, and to where he got was, I mean, it changed the world. I mean, there's people's whole careers, I mean, are in big part to Bernie. I mean, mine included. So, like, if you want it, you just got to work hard for it. You have to have a big old heart. Be willing to close hands, can't receive, and go and get it for yourself. Because Bernie did. Bernie really did, and a lot. I mean, that was the most amazing thing for me to see. Someone who looks like me rise to the top and be gracious and humble about it. Man, there ain't nothing I can't do that. All right. Like, that was such a big inspiration. I think everybody can be inspired by that.
I love it. That was awesome, Jeremy. Again, you are so wise. You are hilarious. You are a delight to talk to.
Thank you so much. I appreciated the time, Janice. Like, honestly, when I'm going to be out in Chicago soon, so we're going to get together.
Yes, please.
Okay, but yeah, let's do it. Like, I really, really thank you for sharing your father with me. He meant the world to me, and he really changed my life. And so I just can't thank you guys enough, and I just can't thank you enough for having me here and for celebrating him still, because, I mean, he deserves the world, and he deserves to be celebrated long after we both dead. So when I get kids one day, I'm gonna teach them about Bernie Mac, and so, you know, they can have Bernie Mac's televisions, sons, podcast, and they can, you know, keep rapping Bernie Mac then.
Yeah. Yes, I love it. I'm there for it. Yes. And there you have it, folks. Another awesome episode of the Bernie Starter Podcast is in the bag. Like, thanks to you who are listening and watching wherever you are. You could be doing anything in your day, and I did not take for granted that you chose to spend these moments of your day with me. My most sincere thanks to the very awesome Jeremy Suarez, who is, like he said, he is the shit. Yes, he is. I am but your humble host, Janice McCullough, mostly known to y'all as Burns' daughter. And like my daddy before me told y'all, I ain't scared of you, mother. You know the rest. Until next time, who you with?